Thanks, Mark. So I have the distinct pleasure of staying between you and the end of the day. So I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, but it was very nice of you to stay. So I appreciate it. And Marcus, for what it's worth, I don't know where you went. I'm a huge ISOTAP fan. I don't know where you went, but we deployed it on our enterprise network, and I couldn't have rolled out V6 actually without it, and I could tell you why later. The other thing that you probably noticed is I'm on a huge animation kick. I clearly have nothing better to do with my time, and I decided to put animations into my slides, and you'll get to enjoy more of that here as we go along. One of the things that you'll note... See, I'm here for your entertainment, people, right? I think I know like half the people in the room, and you all know that I'm here to entertain you, right? So I contemplated not even putting this in here, right? Because, you know, you guys all know, you guys have all, you know, seen this, heard this. When I was talking to John this morning, when we were actually preparing these slides, because they didn't exist 5 hours ago, he said, like, who cares?
John who?
John Letty.
Because your partner here is, your boss.
I work for John, and he's probably not in the room at the moment. He's golf
John
to do his son.
John, like Jamie and Jamie from earlier. What's you guys?
I don't know, man. I don't know. But we contemplated not even putting this into the deck, to be honest with you, because to whoever said it earlier, it's kind of like, old news, right? But we did, because this is actually where it all began. This is why it all began. You'll notice that 97% of our modems are in V6 only. So you say 97% of what? 34 million. It's a lot of modems, right? We're talking to the tune of 32, 33 million K modems under V6 only mode. Less than 750,000 are left in IPv4 mode. Probably by the end of this year, early next, they'll be all off. But to most of you guys here in the room, you don't care, right? That's an internal Comcast thing.
So why is this actually?
So interestingly enough, there was a statement made earlier about harvesting IPv4 addresses. And I think I'll just leave it there, right? We did not have 32 million IPv4 addresses on the KMO network.
No, I mean, why do you still have some V4?
Old devices. They're old. I thought you were asking me why we did this, but okay.
No.
I take my answer back. They're old. They're old devices, and we have a team back at the office that does like EOL type activities, and eventually over the next year or so, especially as DOCSIS 3.1 comes out, those devices will just get end of life, swapped out with other equipment, and they'll go away, right? So John, if he was here, he'd be like, you know, turn the rest of them off, take the V4 blocks away. You know, he's very eager to get those things off, and so am I. But I just know it'll happen over a matter of time. So like I said, we're trending towards 100% of that aspect of our infrastructure being IPv6 only. And like I said, to most people in this room, you guys don't care. That's really a Comcast thing, right? That's really something that we use internally. More animations. I caught myself feeling a little woozy at one point as I was going through these slides. I felt like, oh man, I'm gonna...
You should look at the big
version. I know, dude. It was chipping me out, and I'm glad I wasn't, half a bottle into something when I was doing these slides. So the path to V6, so you'll notice these are some internal figures, little eye chart-ish, but off to the right you'll notice that these links are links and their relative traffic for V4 versus V6. You'll notice that almost every column in the right-hand side is a larger number than the one immediately to its left. That means those links happen to be more V6 than V4. And, that happens to be to a large search engine company somewhere in the world. This one is basically how Facebook views us from a traffic point of view. More of their traffic to us is now V6. Ooh, Freudian slip. Is V6 versus V4. So, this is a kind of a modest chart for now, but Mark, when we do this again, later this year, early next, that line, you guys should get used to what that line looks like, right? Because that is the X1 migration to IPv6. So we have about 30,000 right now, and that migration, as you see, happened basically in, that line went up that far within like 48 hours.
So those are V6 only hosts delivering content to your user?
Yeah. Yeah, V6 only set-top boxes delivering video to my customers.
Yeah. Not a lot of Comcast users in here say that.
Yeah, that's, yeah, oh yeah, yeah, I apologize, yeah. X1's is basically our set-top box platform. But like I said, get used to the seeing that line in that way, because, you know, for any, you know, US people here or expats, what have you, before you get your taxes done this year, that line will be something to the tune of 14 million. Yep. Yeah. And mainly for a lot of the reasons that Mark has talked about, you know, just V4 just does not give us enough room to grow. Right. And this is kind of something that's, you know, a little bit historical, but this is basically, and I really wish I had the chart from like way back, but this is basically our deployment of native dual stack broadband today. So 18 plus million customers with native dual stack broadband connectivity. So where does this take us? It takes us to where we're going from here, right? So there's a internal project that basically, you know, we've been, you know, and I give credit to John because he's the marketing genius behind this acronym, but Route 6 for us. There is an initiative that we're taking internally, and hopefully Jen will grill me on this, but we are looking at really, you know, a lot of people see this information. They say, hey, you know, so cool, you know, what are you going to do now? I mean, I get that question every week. Somebody in the elevator, hey, so what are you doing next? And then, you know, I basically said, you know, my boss asked me the same question about 6 months ago. And I said, you know, I spent the past 10 years turning V6 on, which is not the same as turning V4 off. So I think we'll spend some time turning V4 off. So from an infrastructure point of view, we are going to do back and front plane V6 only, right? So when we interconnect with people, we are now talking to organizations that have high volumes of traffic to say, hey, no more dual stack interconnection ports between our two networks. Why? Why bother, right? You know, if the majority of your traffic is already IPv6 with us, what's the point? Why go through the operational, headache? Why even bother? Some of the things on the, you know, the backplane side of things, you know, managing the network infrastructure using IPv6 only, SSH, SNMP, SNMP traps, even syslogs, even though, you know, the vast majority of messages probably get ignored, right? Some of the other things that we're looking at, zero touch provision, right? So anybody who's ever racked and stacked equipment in bulk, you know, we've had this conversation with a number of people internally. The whole idea of, you know, taking it from the warehouse, shipping it to its location, plugging in a console port or a terminal server, going through the initial base configuration. What if that were just something that you could just plug in, it automatically gets its IPv6 address, and it configured itself within, say, 35, 45 minutes later, and it's up and running as a router. It's now managed without any, you know, any human, minimal to no human intervention, right? And of course, for us, V6 only in the cloud. As you noticed, you know, once X1 goes all V6, and X1 is a huge customer of our internal cloud, you say to yourself, what do you need V4 for on the cloud? Well, a year ago, when you know, for those, you know, who follow OpenStack, for example, which is one of the platforms that we use, you really couldn't do V6 only with OpenStack, right? With some other cloud platforms, you could. Now you're getting closer to being able to do that, right? And it's not just an OpenStack story. But for us, what we want to go ahead and do is we want to take all that cloud infrastructure and make it V6 only, mainly for, you know, obviously because we're our own biggest customer there. And if and where we need V4 personalities, we'll look at things like, you know, SIIT and some other stuff like that. That, you know, if Tor were here, he'd be able to comment further on. But that's really kind of the direction that we're taking from an infrastructure point of view. So now, fast forward to services. So again, you know, recurring theme here, as you saw in the first few bits, for us, V4 as a service is a huge angle and a huge part of the Route 6 concept for us. And it doesn't apply just to broadband, right? So, you know, there may be some people in the room who basically have already started going down this path. I know Axel mentioned, you know, lightweight 6/4 or 4/6, sorry. We're looking at something very similar, right? We're just going to use MAP, and we're going to use it for broadband, residential broadband. 1 year from now, when Mark organizes, you know, this thing again, we'll come back and we'll have a lot more to tell you about broadband, V4 as a service, Route 6. But for us, it's really a mission to kind of take it and make the various parts of the network V6 only. I envy Axel in some ways, right? Because, you know, you were able to start off with V6 only. On one hand, you know, that's a great place to start, right? To be able to do that from day one. I'm sure you had your share of challenges. For us, I have a different set of challenges in the brownfield where I now have this massive network that now I have to systematically turn V4 off on. But it'll give me something to do for the next few years, right? So for us, you know, we are very much looking at virtualizing the BR function because you say to yourself, hey, you know, if V4 traffic is declining anyway, You know, why would you buy specialized hardware for it, right? And all the technology is there. And of course, we have GRE over V6 that we use for Xfinity Wi-Fi, which, you know, we'll probably move to, you know, maybe something different in the future. And it's interesting, the talk about Wi-Fi and V6 only. One of the things that we talked about as part of that, as, you know, version 2.0 of Wi-Fi and V6 is exactly that, turning off IPv4. But for us, we need to make it so that when a V6 only host goes to the V4 internet, that it can still get to content, right? And content is kind of a separate discussion. But we also know that there are some hosts out there that may show up on a public Wi-Fi, like Xfinity Wi-Fi, that cannot do IPv6. So we're currently looking at that, and we're hoping, you know, 1 year from now we can share with you some findings and some information there. As you know, X1, V6 only, and of course, there's many other, every other service under the sun inside of Comcast is going V6 only. Voice, V6 only, no V4. Xfinity Home also has a migration strategy to IPv6 only, and frankly, even if they don't, we're probably going to map them anyway. So they're going to be you know, free of V4 in the not too distant future, come hell or high water. So what's next? So Route 6 actually means something, right? We have every letter in the acronym that actually represents something: real time controller, the brain, our overlay services, things like voice, video, et cetera. You know, V4 is a service. The underlay, which is basically a large part of what we're all here to talk about. You know, V6 as the next generation underlay network and transport. Telemetry, I got to tell you, there's a guy that I got to get to come here, Mark. Brian Field, you know, also a very close coworker, is doing just amazing things with telemetry. We did some work early on kind of in other areas of measurements in telemetry, but Brian is just doing some crazy things, and you'll see some acronyms here that I'll throw out for you. And of course, extensible, right? The CPE and the virtual machines are all endpoints. They play a huge part in how this stuff goes forward. If you look at every major deployment of V6 around the world, if you just take a peruse down the world V6 launch page, you'll notice that many of the people who kind of rose up quickly, you know, the Telus's, the Freeze, you know, even the Comcast of the world, right? We were able to kind of make that move because we were able to control and implement and manage the software that goes into those CPEs. Huge part. And of course, the 6, you know, is core to everything that we're doing, right? Including segment routing. You'll notice OpenBMP is something that is playing a huge role for us in the telemetry space. FDIO, BPP, you know, very impressive work that, you know, I think is safe and fair to say that was initiated by Cisco. Pretty impressive stuff. And of course, you're going to miss the humor in that picture, but basically from a telemetry point of view, it says send and collect all the data, right? Don't hold anything back, right? Because that, you know, one of the biggest problems that I've seen at Comcast and many other places is, you know, if I'm collecting a bunch of good data, I'm not gonna I don't think to share it with Mark or Eric or Lee or somebody, right? But the reality of the situation is if you don't, then Mark is gonna go collect his own copy of the same data that I already have, right? And so will Eric and so will Andre, right? So what we're doing is you know, we're kind of going on that mantra that says, hey, collect it and collect as much as you can, but make sure you share it, right? Because that's really the key in really making the most of telemetry. One of the things that we will talk very specifically about here as far as the 6 part of Route 6 is really where segment routing and kind of the underlay kind of come into play here. So one of the things that we are looking for, and for many of the people who have been, you know, talking or watching the segment routing work, we've been having, you know, a lot of kind of long-standing discussions about segment routing and V6. One of the things that we intend to do with SR is we have an IP video kind of technology that we're looking to deploy, and now it is now V4 only, right? But as we kind of take that leap towards making it V6 only, one of the things that is happening is we're taking a closer look at exactly how we are delivering that from a transport point of view. Today, it heavily leverages IPv4 multicast. Truthfully, mainly because we already have V4 multicast deployed across our network entirely. One of the conversations that we've had internally for probably 2, 3, 4, 5 years now is do we need V6 multicast? The answer for us is no, right? So what our intention here is if you look at the x86 box in the upper left-hand corner as the source of the V6 multicast, the big cloud in the middle, our goal is to never have to enable V6 multicast across the core of that network, right? I hear horror stories from John and other people that work at Comcast that the whole process of turning V4 on was actually painful. And I said to myself, yeah, I don't think I want to do that. But what we do recognize here at the perimeter, the other side, the other edge, we do need V6 multicast, but we need it facing the customers, facing the endpoints. So what better way to get it from an origin to a destination without WAN multicast in the middle other than SR, right? So our use case, which is something that we are building to right now, is having that origin SR enable those packets, unicast them to all the edge points that have to then in turn multicast them to clients. And that's basically our use case for IPv6. It is extremely legitimate, and for us, there's a huge amount of value for us in not having to implement V6 WAN multicast in the big cloud in the middle. So, with that, I think I'm done. Maybe early, maybe not. Happy to take questions, comments. Ice?
Well, one question. So, x86 box that does replication, how many replications does it make?
So you got to consider the fact that there's going to be, you know, thousands of CMTSs, many multicast groups, right? So there will be a non-trivial. To be perfectly honest with you, I don't have an exact number for you. We're still kind of working some of that stuff out. But it you know, our view is that it'll still be
less than 35 million.
Probably.
No, that was the number of homes you have. Right?
Yeah, right.
And so worst case, you're streaming video to 35 million.
Yeah.
And you're going to be less than that, at least.
Yeah, and the other thing here that I'll flip forward here with this thing, if it'll let me. Yeah, come on. This is where you will get vertigo, right here. I told you I was on an animation kick, man. So ISIS question is very interesting. So the other thing you'll take notice here, there is an alternate use case, which is kind of an improvement. As we learn more about this model, we can then put children caches of this x86.
It would be a great feature.
So for this x86 box, right, we could put children versions of it closer to the CMTS, right? So then you can go unicast to unicast to multicast closer to the CMTS. So there are a number of optimizations that we're currently exploring, still SR enabled, right? Andre.
Did you see any performance improvement or change after having switched to V6?
We did see, for HSD, we do see V6 being faster. Still early to tell for X1 and the video platform. We've definitely observed performance benefits similar to what Facebook has observed with mobile devices. I think he was able to better measure and see more pronounced benefits.
How do you explain this performance improvement?
Magic. No, I'm kidding. I think one of the biggest explanations for us is the home gateway, right? The home gateway has to do just a lot less work to move the V6 packets compared to V4 packets, right? That's really what some of the conclusions, because we did some analysis around the gear in the core of the network, like, you know, the ASR9Ks, you know, the MX960s, etc., and there's virtually no difference from that point of view. So we came to the conclusion, we zeroed in on the fact that it was something in the access network, you know, and then you put that closer down to, you know, the e-router itself, for example. One of the, you know, to offer you the kind of the reverse of that, one of the things that we've gotten reports from the field recently is Netgear has some pretty high-end Wi-Fi routers that are retail. They don't have a cable modem embedded. And one of the things that we're finding is that people, Netgear, for example, are deploying new gear, and they're not turning on feature parity for V4 versus V6. So what you're finding is Netgear is kind of artificially slower for V6 because they haven't turned on some of the acceleration features that kind of go, that are available to it, right? So as that's kind of getting out there more and more, we're finding that that's an area that needs to be cleaned up. Frank?
What's your experience with ZTP?
What's your experience with ZTP?
Zero. We're working on it. Yeah, I mean, we have it's currently a project in flight right now. We have a huge router deployment that's coming down the pike right now, and one of the things that is going to go hand in hand with that, you know, that refresh is exactly ZTP. You know, we're hoping from an operational point of view that we can kind of simplify that process, you know, exponentially. We don't have, you know, this is a first for us. So we, you know, and we haven't actually even deployed the first router yet with ZTP, but we're looking forward to it.
Thank you. That is not actually a question, it's a suggestion, because this architecture you are showing in mm-hmm. this slide, something Dino Farinacci is working on for a long time, it's based on the Lisp encapsulation. You may like it or not, but he has good progress on the control plane, so maybe talk with him, because...
We know Dino, we've heard of Lisp.
It's not about the encapsulation, it's the control plane, it's yep. really interesting.
Got it.
That was Luigi, the co-chair of the Lisp working group.
It's all very clear now.
But it's a valid point. I mean, you know.
Yeah, yeah. We did. We really did. We did talk to Dino.
And
absolutely.
Once you open that bag, there's like 10 other things you can use. Question about this one.
Mm-hmm.
Is it sitting inside your network, or could it possibly sit out in some other network that you know, peer with, or maybe out on the internet, or what have you?
It is currently inside our network. It's software that we write. Ideally, the answer depends, right? I think in from a practical point of view, if that origin were to be outside the network as a multicast origin, doesn't look so good, right? Because now you have to have multicast between inter-domain
multicast. This is unicast, right?
No.
This is unicast SR down to that thing.
So yes. So when you qualify
that's
the
question. That's what I'm asking is that, yeah.
When you qualify the question, then the answer is it could effectively live in other places, yes. Absolutely.
So then you would have an IPv6 SR packet with an extension header on it going over the internet or over a connection to some outside.
Hypothetically speaking, yes.
Sounds like your Brian needs to talk to that Brian. About whether or not extension headers are necessary on the internet.
Well, so if I can perhaps find a middle ground there, in cases that we would do that, we might actually have a relationship with that company, right? So like there are other, so you could mitigate some of that by, you know, having some relationships with people, right? So
you verify the path.
Right, or that link might not be, you know, an internet link. It would be kind of, you know, an internet connection.
Because you know what's on the other end of the line.
Exactly. Yeah, it's like, you know, semi-trusted, you know, origin, right? Yep, we could do that. We can bridge those two worlds together. Any other questions, comments?
On the way over to Luigi again.
Yep.
Okay, well, never mind.
At least it would work right out of the box with the inter-domain stuff.
Yep.
Okay, the comment is with Lisp it would work out of the box.
Let's go from detail to general again. So you were talking about sort of virtualizing the V4 delivery and all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
When you're looking at the crystal ball and making predictions, when will you basically make that a second class service or even turn it off?
Ah, very good question. So we actually had this conversation often. One of the reasons why I contend, and I've been kind of pushing for virtualizing that function, is because I believe in the not too distant future, V4 will start to disappear all by itself. This year, and it's not in this slide, right now my traffic is about 25-30%. My internet traffic is 25-30% IPv6. I could assure you that by the end of this year, it'll be 50% or better, right? By the time Mark does this next year, right, or let's just say by Christmas of 2017, I think V6 traffic at Comcast will be 75%. So my point being here is you can't really have the conversation that you're talking about until V4 is really on the slide down, right? So we think we see, you know, that we see the light at the end of that tunnel. Being able to turn it off entirely, that's a difficult question, but I see V4 becoming a second class citizen, you know, in the not distant future, end of 2017, 2018, maybe.
Okay. Additional questions: the 25% that you're seeing, mm-hmm. you know, being there in 2 years or in a year's time, that's basically your customers reaching content that isn't available on V6.
That is my customers who are V6 enabled reaching content that is V6 enabled, right? So the 25-30% of my internet traffic right now is V6.
No, I mean the future, the remaining V4 traffic, that's mainly your eyeballs looking for content that's not available on V6.
That's step one. Or it is old home networking equipment that doesn't do V6.
Okay.
right? Equipment that I don't control, for example, like if I pick on Netgear, for example.
The proverbial IP camera and stuff like that.
Yep. Alrighty. Everybody's hungry or thirsty or both.
Lee's there.
You didn't take a minute to talk about commercial services.
Commercial for us, Lee, we have twofold. We have DOCSIS-based commercial services, which all are V6-enabled today. We are launching this year static IPv6. It actually brings up a very important question, because one of the things that becomes a hot topic for commercial services is use of V4 as a service for commercial services. So one of the things that we're, going back to this gentleman, and I don't know your name yet, as V4 continues to slide away as kind of the dominant protocol, you say to yourself, well, wait a minute, so that same statement would apply to commercial, except commercial customers also host their own content on the other end. One of the things that we're doing as part of our push this year for commercial static V6 is basically making sure that my customers are armed with the information that they need to turn their services on for V6. Truthfully, Lee, I think commercial customers will be one of the last to kind of find themselves deprecating IPv4, right? And the same statement would apply to people who have like Metro E or fiber. I think those customers are kind of in a class of themselves because of the nature of what they do behind their service.
Hijacking the mic on the path. I have heard rumors that ISP in US is offering for its business customers IPv6 only to the CPE. And the goal is to use those CPE doing VPN and transferring inside the VPN over V6, V4, and V6. So inside the VPN, V4, V6, outside V6 only. So not a single IPv4 address at all. Is it you or? Okay. Is it you?
We are looking at that, right? We're also looking at that. And that's the part of V4 as a service. I mean, that has to be done very carefully, right? I mean, that clearly the customers have to be part of that discussion, inheriting that, if you know what I mean, right? But yeah, I mean, we're also looking at that as well as part of the Route 6 initiative and the underlay and the overlay. The overlay is V4 as a service, and even though it just says broadband, right? It could say data services, right? It could be commercial or resi.
Okay, thank you very much, John. That
thank you, Mark. Fantastic.